Thank you, Mr. Mayor. In the grounds of King's College, near the bridge over the Cam, you can find a white marble stone inscribed with a few lines of Chinese script. Many people, even many locals, probably pass it by without knowing what it is. But the stone contains parts of some verses by a Chinese poet. Zhu Jimo studied in Cambridge during the early 1920s and fell in love with the city, as well as with English romantic poetry. And later, he wrote a poem entitled, the translation is quite difficult, something like Taking Leave of Cambridge Again, including the few lines that are inscribed on the stone. The poet died in a plane crash some 10 years later back home in China, but he became very famous in his native country, even more so because the Cambridge poem, is included in Chinese school literature textbooks. And so it's known to virtually every child educated in China. And the poem and the stone are one of the reasons why this city is such a popular destination for Chinese visitors. And it says something about the nature of this city. 90 years ago, at a time when visitors from China or most other countries would have been far fewer in number than we're used to today, Zhu Jimo could have been regarded as something of an outsider, but he felt welcome here and became very attached to Cambridge, feeling himself to be part of the community. And today, this is a city that welcomes people of many cultures, nations, and backgrounds, and treats them with humanity, whoever they are, wherever they come from. May that always remain the case, and may it be reflected in all of our discussions and decisions.
Please tell our councillors to use their microphones all the times. Public, I have a difficulty hearing this discussion. Please raise your hand and you have an officer. We're not expecting a fire alarm test, but fire exits are located at the back and front of the council chamber. For wheelchair users and those with mobility issues, please make the way to the safe waiting area at the Peaks Hill Stairway. Council officers will be on hand to assist if they're required. Accessible unisex toilets located outside the council chamber, opposite the members' room. A drinks machine is located opposite committee room 1. Cambridge City Council is still in this meeting and a copy available on the full view of the meeting for the next coming days. Could I ask members to be concise with their contributions and show respect to their fellow members? Can I approve the minutes of the meeting of the Council held on the 25th of February 2016, which can be found on pages 9 of the agenda? Minutes of the extraordinary Council meeting that took place on the 23rd of March. Be on the agenda of the annual council meeting. Could I ask if there are any apologies?
Mr. Mayor, Councillor Gearing and Councillor Sullivan said no apologies.
Anyone else here? Yeah. Members who have received invitations to attend the annual proclamation of Reach Fair, which this year takes place on Bank Holiday Monday, the 2nd of May. If you'd like to attend and haven't yet replied, please can you do so as soon as possible by contacting the city no later than the next Tuesday, 19th of April. Majesty the Queen's 90th birthday, Cambridgeshire County Council is holding a beacon lighting event at the Shire Hall on Thursday the 21st of April at 7 p.m. I will be attending the ceremony, which is to open to the public. If any members would like to attend, please again ask Lucy for further information. I'd like to ask members now to declare any interest in the items of the agenda for us this evening. Members are reminded that they can declare interest at any time during the meeting if any occurs to them during the debate tonight. Councillors Owens, Pitt, Green and Saunders, whose terms on the council end in May, have decided not to stand for re-election. All have given outstanding service to their respective wards on the council committees. This year we are losing some extremely able members, and on behalf of the council, I thank them all for the service to the city. To those of you who are standing for re-election, I wish you all well. The following people wish to address the meeting: Anthony Carpin, Mike Sargent, Sophie Draper, and Wendy Byrne. Under the scheme allowing members of the public to speak at council meetings, each speaker must address his or her comments to the chair of the relevant committee or the relevant member of the executive. Each question or statement must be limited to 3 minutes, with a further 2 minutes to supplementary question or comment on something has been said. There is normally an overall time limit for public question of 30 minutes, including the time taken by responses to questions, but this can be extended at my discretion. So could I ask Mr. Carpenter to please come forward and ask his question?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Good evening, councillors and members of the public gallery. I've been doing some research for neighbourhood plans being developed by a number of residents' associations following a recent Prince's Foundation event that several of you attended. And I've been going around also photographing parts of historical, if I can call it the modern Cambridge, university parts of Cambridge, learning lots about the history of our city and the unfortunate part this institution and some of its predecessor or sister institutions played in the demolition of some fine buildings and community venues. And this week my heart has been absolutely broken at having found out some of the ones that have been destroyed. Just before I go on, how many of you saw the blog post that I put up titled hashtag lost Cambridge? So good, we've got 2, 3, 4, 5, splendid. This is excellent. Because I've been putting some of those photographs up there. Now given that Cambridge assessment is due to vacate many of the premises over the next few years, my question really is, will there be a strategy from the council and Cambridge Assessment on what to do with the vacant buildings? Because we have a huge chance to right some of the historical wrongs. I also mentioned in the question the example being of the former Theatre Royal. Cambridge used to have a huge theatre that seated nearly 2,000 people, and unfortunately it got demolished in 1962. The county council used to have a roller skating rink that was demolished on the year of my birth. So it's the site I was thinking specifically of in the question, it was near the University Arms, but having gone into a Twitter spat with former councillor Rosie Steele, the site opposite the Catholic Church along the corner of Harvey Road seems ideal once Cambridge Assessment move out of it to be the site of a brand spanking new theatre, money aside. So I guess my question really is to the council, do you have a strategy for what to do with all those vacant buildings when Cambridge Assessment is moved out of them? Thank you.
Who's answering that one? Councillor Blackburn.
Yes, welcome back, Mr. Carpin. I have the pleasure of answering the question. I won't give you a history lesson, that's definitely Mayor's role to do that. But in terms of how Cambridge changes over the years, clearly several factors come to bear. Trends, economic factors are all part of why streets change, buildings change. In terms of the planning role, clearly we have local plans in place in previous years. Local plans or town and city plans were in place. But we always start with
and the community hub that we don't currently have. And for them that would be ideal, also for us ideal, as extra meeting space that currently it's maybe the Friends Meeting House that that is incredibly booked up for that. I think that's that in particular is a conversation that a number of people want to have. Also a query around the issue of alcohol licences, which a couple of people said they will take to future meetings. So I shall leave it there. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Suitable environments for buses, for cycling, suggestion at this stage from Liberal Democrats that somehow there is no need to improve these roads is contrary to what they've been doing over the last 18 months. So, first of all, there is a recognition which we thought was across the political spectrum that there needed to be improvements on railway routes that also take account of the need to generate a good public realm and environment when changes are made. So that's the first strand, and then the second strand is no, we do not believe that that somehow there is some magic bullet solution that means that there is no need to tackle the routes into the city. There has to be both, and the measure of the proposals that will be, particularly on the city-wide measures, will be the subject, we believe, of consultation, with that similarly being a matter for the city deal to decide in the summer, will be that there needs to be an assessment of how the two work together. So we think it's a false hope and misleading if any politicians in this chamber or candidates in elections go around suggesting that suddenly there is no need to have a look at Milton Road.
Would Ms. Draper please come forward to ask that question?
Evening, everyone. I'm Sophie Draper and I'm 22 years old. I live in a shared house in Cherry Dixon, and although I'm very lucky to have a nice landlord, I don't get money off my rent for being under 25. I pay the same amount as any other adult would for gas, electricity challenging the local plan. The planning department and its urban design and conservation teams play a vital role in safeguarding the unique character of Cambridge and supporting the quality of life of our local communities. And the best possible legal advice is now needed to defend the local plan. Residents are therefore extremely concerned at the loss of such experienced senior council officers. Is the leader of the council able to reassure us sufficient resources are in place to ensure that our city's unique character and the quality of its community life are not only defended, but enhanced and protected? Thank you. Yeah. management level who is engaging in partnership with the colleges, the major developers. And I think that was, a lot of people think that that was actually reflected in the consultation, recent consultation on historic core. And I mean, in support, this goes back to central government policy and the cuts that are biting so hard that they're leaving a heritage city like Cambridge, which is loved the world over, without adequate resources to deal with all the growth issues. I mean, this is something that's impacting on local communities. For example, we talked earlier on about Milton Road. There should have been those reports completed on the all the historic approaches into Cambridge, and Milton Road was one of those roads that was supposed to have had a report done. So what my question is, what positive constructive action can the community take? For example, can the council support some form of community action that Anthony Collins talked about, or Friends of Cambridge, or, you know, there are lots of possibilities. What can we do that would help in a positive way, given that you are facing, you know, having to make quite severe cuts? Thank you.
Well, we were not on this side in charge when choices were made, but the changes in the built environment and conservation team effectively recognise that you need to link both the built environment and the conservation team together. And I agree with that, just as I've explained our commitment to joint planning with our neighbours. We do have professional conservation officers in that team, and we continue to resource major pieces of work like the historic core review that you mentioned. And also, we've been listening to residents' associations, as in Barrow Road, where they've been asking for conservation area status. So we continue to undertake significant work, and if the Federation of Cambridge Residents Association wants to meet and discuss the issues, I'm happy to follow that up.
We now turn to agenda item 4A, the recommendation of the Licensing Committee of Gambling Act 2005 Statement of Policy Revisions. The recommendation is set out on pages 37 and 38 of the agenda. Is there any debate? Now we go to the vote, please. Council, all those in favour of recommendations? Now turn to agenda item 4B, the record.
I thought
members of staff to make choices. Do they want to apply for the new roles or do they not? And so in each of the two cases, the members of staff have had a great opportunity, if they wish to apply for the shared service role. And in this occasion, the head of legal services has decided not to. We are a council that's determined to be open about these measures because the public's got the right to know. Councils and local authorities generally have very clear procedures and entitlements where people have given significant service in terms of both their entitlement to redundancy payments and or pensions. So it's important that we put that into the public domain. So this is reporting that and approving in council those payments. And in this case, the payment to the current head of legal service. We have in the head of legal service an outstanding individual. This isn't a time for the full eulogy because this is not the time when the current postholder is going to retire. But and there will be a full occasion for the council to have that discussion and also to thank him for his contribution. Simon Pugh has, well, between the two members of staff we're covering today, they've had 78 years of local authority contribution. And Simon Pugh has head of legal services worked for this council for 31 and a half years. I'll keep my remarks short on this occasion, but as other members know, we have had a hugely able advisor and advocate, and in addition to his advice to the council in the monitoring officer role, we haven't, in my brief period on the council, which is a mere 12 years coming up compared to 31 and a half years, I'm not aware of any scrapes that we've got into as a council, or particularly, obviously, we have had occasions rightly where the behaviour of councillors as individuals has been investigated, but I'm not aware of any scrapes, but that is in large measure, I think, because he has forewarned us and given us a culture of understanding of some of the issues that we have to take serious cognizance of as councillors. So we haven't had any major problems because we've had an excellent monitoring officer. But the report is essentially to approve a severance payment to the head of legal service, who will continue and has indicated that given that we have an appointment process for a shared head of legal service for three councils, that in the interim he will continue to provide us the excellent service that he has over a period of only 31 years.
I will keep my comments brief as well, Mr. Mayor. The Lib Dem group also supports the item 4B and the comments that the leaders made. The only comment I would add, clearly there will be other opportunities to thank Simon for his service to this authority, but it's my observation is one of also being a short service member, like the leader on this authority, is that it's always good to have a good lawyer. And the characteristics that Simon's always brought to the role is being calm and cautious. And that's always very good when you have a room full of characters.
I'll now go to the vote. Please can I see all those in favour of the recommendation? Who's
Council has undertaken a whole range of reviews and in terms of efficiency has changed over time. Again, going back to some of us new people like Councillor Cantrell and myself, both been here for 12 years, we've gone through a series of changes in terms of the number of directors. Generate assets and move forward. You can't always be looking back. person who knows some of these things is cast off, so I'm glad that he has that ability to do so over the next few months. Thank you.
So, you wouldn't have heard that if I had called it earlier. Councillor Bailey.
Yes, Mr. Mayor, I'd like to say that the Lib Dem group supports both these recommendations here. We respect Simon Payne's decision to take on Glasgow as new, but he is a substantial public servant and has presided over some very important aspects of the council's operations for some considerable time over a period of immense change. I look forward to, kind of, as others have said, rehearsing more about that when we have the chance to do so when Simon himself is present. But meantime, support the recommendations.
Thank you for that. So we now go to the vote. Please, can I see those in favour recommendation?
That's unanimous.
Thank you very much. Now we go to agenda item 5. This item will last for a maximum of 30 minutes. At the conclusion of the 30 minutes, Executive Council or leader, as appropriate, may provide a written response to any questions that have been covered. Will the councillors please put their questions in the order shown on the grey paper? Councillor Austin has the first question. The Executive Council Chair will normally have up to 2 minutes to reply. The questionnaire will have 2 minutes to put a supplementary question or seek clarification of response to the original question. Executive Council Chair will normally have a further 2 minutes to reply to the supplementary question. Questions? Councillor Austin?
Question one, please. Thank you, Mr. Mayor. The General on Sunday Market Service is a commercial service. It currently generates a modest return to council. A service review has recently been undertaken with the aim of simplifying what was an extremely complex pricing structure for market pitches and the equally complex associated administrative system. This is also aimed at aligning our fees and charges to other similar markets. A report setting out the results of the review and associated market trade consultation and recommended changes in pricing and associated terms was approved at March Scrutiny Committee. The approved increases in charging rates affect around a third of all pitches. Two-thirds of the 99 pitches remain at exactly the same rates as they did before. The only category that goes up by 30% is the Sunday premium category. This goes up by a grand total of £8.47 today. The change rates this weekend rate, so the new Sunday market standard rate is the same as the Saturday market standard rate. And the Sunday premium rate is the same as the Saturday premium rate. And the reason for this is that the Sunday market rate was set when we had very low occupancy. The Sunday market now has 100% occupancy. It's the most popular market of the entire week, and just three pitches have become available on Sunday markets since March 2015. Saturday, at 99% occupancy, is the next most popular day, so harmonising the weekend rates was considered fair and reasonable. If the party opposite thinks otherwise and believes that harmonising these rates were unfair, I'd be fascinated to find out why. The only change that affects a large number of pitches over a large number of days is the increase of 10% moving the B category into the standardised B category. This works out as £1.77 per day. The surcharge on hot food vendors is related to a disproportionate increase in utility and cleansing service costs arising from hot food. There's been a 62% increase in hot food traders over the last 18 months. Nearly 10% of traders now on the market are hot food vendors. Current water utility budgets are overspent by 356%, and electricity budgets by 59%. We spend over £25,000 a year on market washdown, £13,000 a year for street cleansing, and over £40,000 a year for drain cleaning, maintenance, and purchase of equipment. Why should other traders who use next to no water or electricity be subsidising hot food traders, Mr. Mayor? Why should a bookseller be paying to clean up after everybody else?
Thank you. Supplementary.
I certainly don't want to just go over what we talked about
Mr. Mayor. The market isn't a charity. It's meant to make money for the council and also for market traders. That's what it's there for. It means we need to make sure the rates are set at a level that brings us an income and also pays for officers to work on issues like bringing in more trade to the market. Mostly, they've been spending their time wrestling on the demented complex charging scheme. The previous administration completely failed to notice the charging scheme was out of date and horrendously complicated. The pricing scheme has been unchanged since at least 2007. I've actually been unable to track down any officers who remember the last time you guys bothered to review it. So as part of the review work, Mr. Mayor, market service was benchmarked against other markets in the country. The changes in rates, including the surcharge, is now consistent with the rates charged by other markets, especially given the occupancy rates and the 5.4 million visitors a year that Cambridge experiences. Comparison with other markets shows that even with the changes, our offer is still extremely competitive in terms of store size, price charge, and facilities provided, although I'm sure you've done all that research yourself. Changes mean there are benefits for traders, a simplified pricing structure, so it's much easier to actually find out what you're supposed to be paying. The simplification of the administrative system frees up staff time to spend on service development opportunities, including increased marketing, promotion activity to drive footfall, trials of additional new offers, such as evening market or themed markets, an additional net income of about £55,000 a year, part of which can be reinvested in service developments and improvements, including what we've already agreed to, which is an extra daily 2-hour cleansing operative between 12 and 2 p.m. every day. Traders who choose to pay by direct debit, which wasn't an option before, will receive a 4% rebate. Oh, perhaps we can put some of the extra money towards making it 40% government cuts, which your party collaborated. And of course, the traders are still finding it all too much. I'm terribly sorry to hear that, because there's an extremely small percentage of traders that are being affected at all. And I believe there are still some commercial pitches available in Bury. Oh no, that would still be more expensive than Cambridge. We all want a thriving market. The changes allow us to pay for the improvements we need. A thriving market is not the same as a market where all the stores are the same as in 1973. I know you haven't got any better ideas about the market. I think your party hasn't had any ideas about the market since at least 2007. This is a question of the usual separate attempt to make political capital when you've got nothing to offer of your own. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Would this be a short, Councillor Roberts?
No.
There's also been increased action days, of which we doubled the number from 6 under Liberals to 12, where a total of 69 tonnes of rubbish was collected last year, 27 tonnes of recycling, and also with great emphasis not only on reuse but also giving to charity. We also have the Love Food Hate Waste, a great campaign that basically involves in the last year 23 events where nearly 1,000 caddies come and keep going, isn't it? So I'm done. Thank you. 23 events across the city, 990 counties have given out a whole range of work that's obviously done with the vibrance of society that adheres to food waste. We've had community cycling champions doing a great job, speaking to 1,300 people, recruited 50 new champions for recycling in central Lisbon's, kept the recycling officer when the contract ran out when the party stopped going in 2014, is that all with total savings of £750,000 coming from waste, caused, we won't go into the reasons why, but caused by government decisions across both South Hams and Cambridge. The knock-on implications are that we will have to merge optimisation, route optimisation across both councils, resulting in the impact that there will be no more recycling rate for Cambridge, but there will be a recycling rate for both South Hams and for Cambridge, which is impossible to decipher when the bin truck is half full of South Hams and half full of Cambridge. So, I won't, as the executive council, be boasting next year about greater frequent recycling rates because, as you know, full well known, the biggest reason why the South Hams have one recycling is they have very large properties, very large gardens. And lastly, to finish on this one last point, recycling rates correlate very heavily with the weather. And there's a reason why that is.
Contraction.
Question four, Mr. Mann. The City Council took over responsibility for lighting the city between 2 a.m. and 6 a.m. On the 1st of April. So, effectively, we, after a lot of negotiation, agreed to pay the council £45,500, which was calculated as the cost, Mr. Mayor, of those 4 hours. As part of those negotiations, we also ensured that the county council took responsibility at their cost for lights in the city centre, particularly near CCTV. And we also continue to take a keen interest in dimming too, because the county council has said that if there was a noticeable loss of safety or impact, that they would open a fresh discussion. So we, because of the county council's cuts, have had to step in. We think it's well worth it for about 40p per household, or 40p per resident, I apologise. But it's not one thing that we would want to do much more of. It isn't this council's job to pay for services that the county council overall be provided.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I'd just like to say a big thank you to the leader for stepping in and keeping the lights on. It's been an issue that the residents of Cambridge were very concerned about, and it was good that the leader, in a sense, took it upon himself to force this change through. I'd just like to ask, there has been confusion in Cherry Inter over the boundary regarding some of the lights. So I'd just like confirmation that this boundary concern has now been sorted out and all the lights will remain on.
Thank you, and it did get some coverage in the Cambridge News, Councillor Ashton. There are boundary roads in the edge of King's Hedges as well, I think also Arbury, and clearly there are boundary roads in his beloved ward of Cherry Hinton. The issue really is that it would look inconsistent to have the lights on the one side of the road and not on the other. And we did point out that out to the County Council. Our understanding is that their response is pragmatic and is that the lights are going to continue on both sides of the road. So not only are we lighting the city, we're also lighting a bit of South Kent.
Councillor Moore.
Question five.
Well, several points. firstly, the question itself was actually asked the wrong executive councillor. It's a decision made by the TTP executive council housing. But you'll be happy to hear I've taken it on myself to answer it. The organisation and delivery of community cleanup days events are led by city event officers, which support with support we basically make procuring our services. Of the council's recycling waste minimization street operations the location and number of events is determined by city council officers using the following criteria, mainly because the cost itself is, as I say, borne by city homes, not by the general. The available budget, the available staff, target states with particularly high density city home properties, target locations where based on fly tipping results and where officers are reporting back high level fly tipping. So, for example, in previous years, clear out days under the Liberals, there were 6 clear out days, they would move around depending on where there was demand. There were usually, from memory, there were 1 and 2 in the north and then 4 in the south and so on. What I think is not to be confused in this 2/3 of council, we've doubled those numbers to 12, now 13, and we've split 7 to the south, 6 to the top, based on offices, grounds, where essentially there's high levels of blight, being aware with digital waste that people have in their houses, people are elderly, people are poor, deprivation is obviously very high, would have the most impact. What I would add to that is obviously we've had some significant success with these. We've included dog shipping, we've included also skip days coming as well, not to be confused with these, and they've been well received by the community. What we do try to focus on is where there's some sort of civil society where people help organise. Maybe I know that Councillor Ashton, for example, has helped before in my own ward as part of his church. So maybe where there's a strong way network to get involved in, where there isn't offices to step in and do well.
Thank you. That's helpful. It's not always clear how these things come about. The issue was originally raised, of course, by our able chair of the Queen Edith's Forum, who couldn't understand it either. I couldn't find any explicit rules or guidance about how this farm is allocated. You've got to understand how any fair funding mechanism could omit the South Area. In its entirety, which is just under half, or just under 20% of the city homes. So that would imply around 20% or 18% of the funding, or no funding at all. Queen Edith's cleanup days have been very well attended. They're at the heart of the ward and in the heart of the social housing area that we have. We do have fly tipping there. We had a mattress this last week, just for an example. My major concern is lack of transparency. It's easy to misunderstand when an explicit formula for sharing funding that's based on the outcomes that are wanted or the need isn't clear. So it's not clear then whether the funding is being used effectively or in a by. Thank you.
I sincerely believe that Councillor Moore is someone I obviously with Councillor Moore, I've been sat in the same committee for a while on the health, the Cambridge Public Health Committee, and I do believe that he cares passionately about his residents. And I'm sorry, I think it's slightly lost there. Originally, when I was emailed by the resident who also emailed with Councillor Moore, Councillor Pippas, she's not here. She asked about could Queen's have a community care that day and made the case for the Saxon State. Now, in the past, the Saxon State, or the in and around the Saxon area, has had a community care day. In previous years, it hasn't. It's sort of been an on-off thing. In my response to her, I said to her that looking at the criteria that we ourselves set for ourselves, I don't, for myself, it's not, I'm not the executive council boards, I don't make decisions, it's not the executive council housing, it's an office-based decision on the density of social housing. We put in an additional community care day. So like Jesus, who made it to my age today, before dying, I performed a miracle. And I have given you your community care day. Now, you can tell your resident that if we do this on the first time, and I hope to see you there with your gloves on, there will be community care day in Queen's. I have also instructed the teams involved to better communicate, not just in terms of how we go about it, but also give some sort of lock into this for at least a couple of years. And in the case of Queen's, that is the case. You will have much time this year.
Councillor Martin Smart.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. It was fairly breathtaking announcement by the Chancellor of the Exchequer in the autumn budget statement that local authorities were going to retain 100% of their business rates, not least that because at the moment we retain 5%, and that is 5 million out of 100 million, and would be completely gobsmacked if we suddenly got self-management of £100 million. What we do know is that local government has an opportunity here, albeit that this is against the backdrop of losing all of our core ground by 2020, and as the departing and soon to be much missed Councillor Owers stated earlier on, county councils, including Northamptonshire, are in severe risk of actually going bankrupt. So there is a working party which has been
government has treated local government as equals or partners. Previous governments have never allowed councils to plan ahead. How can we plan ahead until we've got some clarity about business rates? We know that the new homes bonus is under threat. We know that we are going to lose all of our core grant. As I said, we lost 40% this year. So we hope that the Conservatives, who are currently in the majority at the Local Government Association, will actually stand up to local government, Mr. Mayor. We are not sure that they will do it effectively, but certainly Labour leaders on the Local Government Association will work with MPs of all parties to ensure that the supposed promise of 100% business rates, which I'm afraid has still got to be evidenced along with a number of other Osborne promises, actually gets delivered.
Okay, we've got another couple of minutes left, so I'll let one more go then. Councillor Rapley,
question 70.
We, as councillors know, have before Christmas provided housing for several Syrian families, and we're aware that there's a further plan from the government in a more coordinated way to bring over a significant number of families in June. The nature of the programme raises several issues for this city, a city that would like to do far more and be more like Heidelberg in terms of the welcome that it's able to give refugees. The government has got what we believe are damaging policies of hemming people in Calais and not offering any assistance. The government has got a denial position because there are significant numbers of unaccompanied teenagers and also other refugees that are coming into the country to such an extent that there's had to be a meeting of all of the county councils in South East England, because Kent had approaching 1,000 teenagers either in care or needing care. So we are welcoming the support that they've given. They have listened to us about minor issues about finance. They've listened to us about the need to give far more information, because if we're going to give the right level of support, we actually need to know a lot more about the nature of the families. They can come from any part of Syria. But what has frustrated us has been that the government hasn't actually provided a proper welcome, and the welcome that Cambridge expects. The one opportunity we hope there will be progress on is that we've had significant numbers of offers of accommodation for single people. And whilst, again, the government is not in any way really meeting the needs of Syrians who've been trying to get through Europe, there is perhaps some opportunity for us to see if there's some housing on offer, which, where there have been incredibly generous offers from people within Cambridge to accept Syrians, and perhaps that will be linked to families, Mr. Mayor, where we can only potentially offer three-bedroom accommodation, but it may be that an adult relative could find accommodation as part of a home where they've been offered a welcome. So we have made progress. We're going to make the most of the limited scheme. We're going to honour the council's initial objective of receiving at least 50 Syrian refugees, and we'll review the position when we reach that.
Okay, thank you for that. Can I ask that the questions that was put forward to get an answer to would be a written response? Changes to the way which the debate motions were agreed by the council in February. A briefly note is on page 5 of the information pack. If you have any questions about the procedure, the head of legal service will ask them. That's very good. We will now turn to the motion titled The New National Minimum Wage, agenda item 6A, to be considered by the council, which will be found on the agenda. A brief note has been circulated to all of you, and a copy can be found in the information packs on pages 7-10. I call on Councillor Robson to move the motion, and Councillor Second motion.
manner of things, deliver a different agenda. An agenda which calls for any support from both these stages provided themselves. We've been told by the Lib Dem Tory coalition and now the Tory government that austerity is essential. In the latest Osborne budget, for once, the mask slipped. It was very clear that the austerity agenda is a facade. We were told that there must be more cuts. In particular, huge cuts to the support of people with disabilities were planned. Yet, at the same time, tax giveaways were also announced for high earners and companies. In a typical Osborne touch, the minimum wage was relabeled as a living wage in an attempt to steal the public perception of the real living wage. The increase in the minimum wage has been introduced mainly to enable the national benefits budget to be cut. Each extra pound of earnings will reduce the means tested benefits paid for by the government. Now, while we can see that it will stop some employers in effect relying on the state to subsidise the paid wage bill, it is also part of a package of cuts which can impact especially hard on those unable to work. Labour was elected to run the City Council in 2014 on the basis of one city, fair for all. This was backed up by an anti-poverty strategy with a wide range of projects to redirect resources to those less well off in our city. One major element was going to develop the living wage in Cambridge, and we employed our very effective living wage coordinator, Theresa Bateman, to run the campaign to promote the living wage to employers in our area. We now have 72 employers in Cambridge committed to paying their staff the living wage. And what's interesting is that includes companies in the service sector, a sector which has often been one known for low pay. Fully accredited living wage employers commit to ensuring that their contractors also pay living wage. So when they look for a cleaning company to clean their premises every day, they look for companies paying living wage. Those service sector companies are paying living wage because their customers expect it. The real living wage is good for business. 37 companies in Cambridge are fully accredited, and a further 25 are working towards requiring their contractors to pay a living wage. And then they too will become accredited living wage employers. As the Living Wage Foundation says, paying a living wage is good for business, good for the individual, and good for society. This motion, Mr. Mayor, proposes that we write to George Osborne and our two city MPs to share our views on the failure new national minimum wage to match the cost of living faced by local Cambridge workers. I hope we can have unanimous support for it.
Thank you. And can we have a second for this? Okay. Would you like to speak now? And before you start, I can tell you you've got 5 minutes and 15 seconds.
Mr. Mayor, I'm pleased to be able to second this motion for a real living wage, which is a real improvement on the government's measures, which by refusing a living wage to the under 25s, discriminates against a large proportion of our population. The government's new national minimum wage of £7.20 an hour is for young people another slap in the face, another sign that they are an unvalued generation by this current government, unworthy of the kind of social mobility and housing that their parents may have taken for granted. And, Mr. Mayor, if you visit the shops and cafes in and around Cambridge, as I'm sure you have, you will see that many of the workers in these companies are under 25. A pay rise might seem like a godsend for these people. These people who work hard and contribute to our economy, they are people who might actually want to be able to save up for a deposit so that they can someday, maybe when they're about 40, move out of mum and dad's house, or who are struggling to pay an extortionate rent or support a young child. I struggle to believe, and I'm sure you do too, Mr. Mayor, that these people are working less hard than their slightly older colleagues. The government, however, appears to think that 18 to 25-year-olds are old enough to get married, to drive a car, to vote for an MP, and to pay their fair share of tax. Arguably, they're holding 18-year-olds to a higher standard than some of their own. But they don't actually think that 18-year-olds are old enough to cope with an extra £1 a magically work harder when they turn 25 and thus deserve to live above the poverty line. They're asking hard-working parents to spread their wages thinly in order to support their grown-up sons or daughters who the government have decided are unworthy of pay that they can actually live on. But in Cambridge, we do need to take a stand for fairness and for promoting a city where people should be able to work where, without having to make a choice between buying food for their family or paying their rent. We need to abide by the spirit of the 2010 Equality Act, which actually made it illegal to discriminate against employees and job seekers because of their age. And therefore, Mr. Mayor, I would encourage everyone here who believes that people should have a fair chance of living out of poverty and actually living with some kind of decent, fair wage to support this motion for the Cambridge Real Living Wage that applies to all working adults and not just the ones that the government have decided are deserving enough.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. As I've commented in this chamber in the past, Mr. Mayor, I welcome the increase in the minimum wage, but as mentioned earlier, its connection with the real living wage is really by name only. And in relation to all other aspects, we should discount it completely in relation to the real living wage. It is quite outrageous that the government, and in particular the Chancellor, decided to hijack a very worthy campaign that had been built over many years in one of his classic smarter, smirkier type of approaches. But as a result of that sleight of hand, Mr. Mayor, the general public, I believe, is now very confused as to what the living wage really is. And as mentioned by the public speaker this evening, many employers are now seeking to exploit that confusion in a way that is doing them no credit at all. Our track record, Mr. Mayor, as an authority on the real living wage, as the public speaker also mentioned, is a reasonably strong one. This party, on this side of the chamber, introduced the living wage in the authority in 2012-13 and started the process of accreditation. The party opposite completed the accreditation and then sought to lobby and campaign other employers in the city to take on board the living wage. We've also passed a motion in this chamber, Mr. Mayor, unanimously supporting the city's ambition to become a living wage city. So, Mr. Mayor, it is important that this motion is passed this evening, because it's important that the public do hear that the new national living wage is not the real living wage. Many residents in this city still find it hard to make ends meet, and Cambridge's success would not be possible if it was not for those employees and those workers who may not get a big salary, who may be below the real living wage, but contribute to this city's success, be they catering workers in University College or carers caring for elderly people across the community. And as a post note, Mr. Mayor, I would like to see the mover of the motion and the seconder accept their colleague's suggestion of a small amendment to write to the County Council and to get the County Council to recognise the real living wage and pay the real living wage as the public speaker suggested. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Okay, Councillor Owens. Well, it's funny that Councillor Kemp says that, so I was always going to start doing it, actually.
You're just like pink food turkey.
You're going to miss him, aren't you?
Yeah. You're going to miss him. Well, I was vegetarianism, so.
Obviously, that's a good lesson. So, my amendment to this motion is simply to add a second one to the end. This is by the council. Resolves to continue to encourage the County Council to seek living wage accreditation. I mean, we could address that. That's what I do as an amendment. I would just think on this brief. I mean, I would go as far as to say that I think that Paul Osborne, which is basically it's a better set of the character, of course, dichotomy between Flashman and Fu Manchu. has done this deliberately because I think although the language is very important in politics, as any council election this city proves, just to forget a few leaders, and I think that it's a deliberate strategy to undermine the national wage, because
forcing the 720 thing is actually more difficult, because there's a, I think, one person in the whole of the region who forces the minimum wage, who is the head of the Labour Party, as a matter of fact. And he has worked out, having had to work out actually enforcing the minimum wage, of course, before this. So actually, first of all, you can make sure this will probably be more of an issue for rural Fenland than the food industry and various other parts of the regional economy. That's one thing. Then we have to really work on the objectives we previously set out to promote living wage in Cambridge, the real living wage, make that crystal clear. And then in the longer term, I think, you know, it thought needs to be given, and I don't think it's appropriate at the moment, because I think that it could undermine the efforts and the messaging even further, but in the longer term, it really is worth thinking, however, given that it was in their job, essentially the same as London, I don't see it receiving as much, there is very much difference. London has its own higher living wage rate. I think that's not something that we need to be talking about now, but in the long term, if there was a great deal of success in this, then we could think about that. And just one last thing, so I think ultimately, you can talk about living wage, it's hugely important, it's something that we've all, on both sides of the chain, given a lot of support over the years, something that we've been working on to sort of assume in 2009, 2008 even, when we did the campaign, amongst colleges, when we seemed to think, like, lads of the Swiss way of new generation to politicians. But at the end of the day, at the end of the day, the rate of wages and making sure people have a decent wage and making sure people have dignity at work will be a role for trade unions. And it's all we're all talking about this, but the living wage really needs muscle behind it. And trade unions and making sure that they have the collective bargaining power to work in collectively for their members in solidarity is the only way in the long run that this will ever, this whole issue will ever truly be addressed.
Thank you. service to my colleagues.